Like to extend special greetings to my friends that are in Central and South America, and just here from the Bachelor home. This is my home office. I'm going to do my best to try and answer some questions that were sent in regarding ecumenism. And the first question being, what does ecumenism mean to you, and where do you believe it will take us in the last days? Now, just for the sake of clarity, a definition for ecumenism is the principle or aim of promoting unity among the world's Christian churches. Unity always sounds like a beautiful thing. Who would pray for disunity? But on the surface, it can contain more than you might think. Now, there's nothing wrong with Christians from various denominations getting together, for instance, if they're in dealing with some natural disaster and working with the Red Cross, if Christians work together to distribute food and emergency supplies, that's a wonderful thing. Or I know of some different Christian ministries that may cooperate with various denominations in distributing things to prisoners. And they're doing some common good thing that any humans could do together. The danger is when Christians are invited to lay aside any of the principles or truths of their denomination for the sake of unity, because truth should always be superior and more important than unity. If we're sacrificing truth for anything, that's really carving up Jesus, because Jesus is the truth. A few statements I might share with you on that. Christ says, for instance, in John 17, verse 17 through 19, "Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. As you've sent me into the world, I've also sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified by the truth." And so the most important thing is truth. And when we think about unity, everyone quotes from John 17, where Jesus says in chapter 17, verse 22, "The glory that you gave me, I've given them, that they might be one, just as we are one." Christ is talking about the oneness of the Father and the Son. "I and them, and you and me, that we may be made perfect in one, that the world might know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me." Well, the oneness between the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, for that matter, they're all one and united in truth. There's an interesting statement that is made by the Spirit of Prophecy. This is in the book Historical Sketches, page 197. "We cannot purchase peace and unity by sacrificing the truth. The conflict might be long and painful, but at any cost, we must hold fast to the Word of God." With that, maybe I should jump to the second question, which is, what relationship do you find between ecumenism and Bible prophecy? Well, of course, we know in Bible prophecy, it says in the last days that this beast power of Revelation 13 is going to push for a global form of united worship. It says all will be forced to worship whose names are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that he'll make an image and compel that everyone worship the image, or the image to the beast, or they cannot buy or sell. And so, obviously, Christians from many different persuasions are going to be encouraged to sacrifice some of their doctrinal beliefs for the sake of this united worship of the beast. And they'll be told that it's a wonderful thing. The beast is a religious power. And Christ says the hour is coming when those who kill you will think they're serving God. So those who worship the image of the beast, by the way, that is John chapter 16, those who worship the image of the beast will think they're serving the true God. And so the Christians from various denominations are going to be asked to sacrifice some of their principles and some of the commandments of God for the sake of unity. This is what happened in Daniel chapter 3. For the sake of common worship, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were invited to sacrifice the commandment about idolatry and bow down and worship the king's image for the sake of uniting the kingdom. And this is going to happen again in the last days. Now, I think it's very interesting that in the world today, the number one religious group is Christianity. There are 2.2 billion Christians in the world. That's talking about Orthodox, Catholic, Protestant, all together, 2.2 billion. Among the Muslims in the world, there's 1.7 billion. So Christianity and Islam are by far the largest religions in the world of the 7 billion people in the world. Islam is growing more quickly than Christianity right now. A lot of that's through biological growth, but they're growing nonetheless. The Pope recognizes that, and this Pope from South America, he realizes the importance of building alliances with the Americas because Catholicism has lost its beachhead. They've lost their hold in Europe. They once really owned Europe. And now across Europe, in France and in England and many places, where once you had church steeples, now you have mosques. And so that's why the Catholic Church realizes it's very important to reach across into Russia. The Pope is building an alliance with the head of the Russian Orthodox Church, with the Orthodox Church, the Greek Orthodox Church, with the Coptic Church in Egypt. They're building alliances because they know they're losing their impact over the first world countries right now. And that's even having an influence here in America. So out of fear, maybe it'll be some major terrorist event or something, is going to cause a confederacy of these Christian religions. Third question, how do you understand the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation, and what do you expect will happen before October 31 of this year and immediately after that date? Well, the word on the street, and it's been published by the Catholic Church, is that Tony Palmer, in harmony with